Hi. My name is Marcin Kostrzewa, and I'm a software developer from Kraków, Poland. And I'm also a theoretical computer science freak, and I'm particularly interested in type theory. So I've decided to share with you one of the most wonderful pieces of type theory, most wonderful in my opinion at least. So if you have ever witnessed a debate between static and dynamic typing advocates, you have probably heard this argument at some point that types are so helpful for proving useful properties of your programs. And, well, this is definitely true. Types are helpful for that. But the other question is, so how many properties have you actually proven so far? Or how many have you seen proven? And I believe that for most of the functional programming community, the answer to this question is close to zero. So my resolution for today is to change this and to show you how you can actually prove something using your types and what you can infer from the function type signature. What can you know just by knowing the function's type? So let's start with an example. So are you by the way familiar with the Haskell type notation? Do you know what that means? Show of hands, yeah? Okay, I guess it's fair enough. So we are given a function f of a polymorphic type. So it promises to work with any type A. It takes a list of A's and returns a list of A's. And our question is, what can we say about this function? What do we know it must obey? What do we know it does? So the first intuition and the first step to solving such a problem is actually thinking about functions with this type signature. What functions do we know with this signature? So reverse or tail are examples. And now the important thing to notice about both tail and reverse is that they work uniformly for any type. So they cannot make any decision based on the elements. They cannot change anything with the elements. They cannot create new elements. Anything they can do is reordering in some uniform fashion. They can remove some elements, but again, they are independent of the type A. So the intuition is that we can't work with this type directly because we don't know what type is it. We can't do anything with it. And this is a useful intuition, but the problem with such an intuition is that we don't really have a way to work with this. We don't really know how to capture this intuition formally so that we can actually say something about such functions. So during this talk, we will try to find an interpretation of types that will allow us to capture such an intuition in a formal way, and that will allow us to prove something useful. And this is a short warning. There may be some scary stuff and dragons appearing on those slides, but please don't be afraid and bear with me for a second here. So first notion we need to define for the purpose of this presentation is a relation. And it's a really simple notion. A relation is just a set of pairs of elements that we will say are related. So if A and B are related in a relation R, it means that the pair AB belongs to this relation. And with this definition, I believe we need a few examples so that it really sticks to your minds. And those examples will also be useful later. So first useful relation here is an identity relation. So an identity relation for any given set is a relation that relates any element with itself and nothing else. So if you have two element set, the identity relation on this set relates first element with the first element, second element with the second element. And nothing else happens in this relation. And the other thing we will need is the interpretation for a function, a traditional mathematical function. So a relation for a function is basically a relation that maps an input to an output. So you are given a function and a set, a domain of this function. So you basically create a relation in which any input is related to the output. And in pure mathematics, this is actually the definition of function. So there is no such thing as function in mathematics that is not a relation. Function is basically a relation in maths. And this is everything we need to know about relations. And now what we need to do is to embed our type system in the world, in the environment of relations. So we want to have a type signature and reinterpret it as a relation, because relations are much more pleasant to work with. We know something about relations. Types are a syntactic constructs that do not actually have an actual meaning right now. So we want to embed them as relations and then work with them. And the most useful intuition for such a relation will be just by program equivalence. So we want to capture the in this relation, we want to capture the notion that two programs do the same thing. So we will try to find out what that means, that two programs do the same thing, find the relation that captures this intuition, and then we will try to squeeze some interesting properties out of this. So I'm going to need to introduce this R mapping. So this is a mapping that allows us to interpret our type constructors as relations. So basically this R with a subindex A is an interpretation of A in the world of relations. And with this in mind, we can jump into actually defining those mappings. So first thing we'll need is primitive types. And what does this mean that two values of a primitive type do the same thing? Well, there's only one possible answer. It's just an identity relation. So true does the same thing as true, and false does the same thing as false in the world of Booleans. And there is no other way around, unless you are okay with exchanging all your trues to falses, but I'm not. So this is why for primitive types, we are using identity relation as the environment. And when we have primitive types defined, we can jump into more involved type constructors. So let's start with pairs. So what does it mean two pairs are related? Well, they are related if the first elements of the pair are related and the second elements are related. So this basically means that if the pairs look the same from the outside, it means that they are related. And so basically, if you have two pairs, you just compare first elements, compare second elements in the respective relations, because you can have pairs of different types, right? But so we just use the relation that you should use for this particular element, compare them, and the pairs are related if the elements are related. And with this definition in mind, we can go into functions, into lists. I'm sorry. So if you recall, we usually define lists as nested pairs. We use this cons operator for nested pairs. And from this definition for pairs, we infer that lists are related when they have the same length and the respective elements are related. So the first element of the first list must be related to the first element of the second list. The second element of the first list is related to the second element in the second list, and so on and so on, until the end of the list. And they have a common end because they have the same length. And now it's time for a short break and checking if you actually understand what is happening around here. So, quick example and quick test. If f is a function relation, what does it mean to extend this f to lists? So what is the meaning of this f relation interpreted as a list in relations? So before I've told you what does it mean that to be a function, it maps inputs to outputs, relates inputs to outputs. And the list type constructor relates lists of the same length element by element. So if you are given two lists, they are related by this relation. If the first element is related to f applied to the first element, the second element is related to f applied to the second element, and until the end of the array of the list. So what does it really mean? Have you ever seen such a mapping? Have you ever seen something similar? Well, you probably have. You may not be aware right now. But to me, it looks like a map function. So this is a relation that takes a list and relates it into the result of mapping function f over this list. And with this example, please remember this. It will come in handy later. And now let's go back to our type constructors. There are two more type constructors we need to cover. And the first is an arrow type constructor, or the function type constructor. So what does it mean that two functions, as in programming language functions, what does it mean that they are related? Well, it means that if they are given related inputs, they give us related outputs. So this is the definition that really captures the intuition about the same behavior. So we are not concerned with the implementation of those functions. What we are concerned with is a behavior. And the behavior of a function is just taking input and giving us output. So related inputs map into related outputs, And this means that two functions are related in the respective relation. And now polymorphism. And by polymorphism in programming languages, in functional programming languages, we usually mean parametric polymorphism. And what does it mean to be a polymorphic type? So it's just a simplification, but it's enough for our purposes. We can treat a polymorphic type, so a type that contains this for all part, we can treat it as a family of types. So for any type substituted for x, we get a type that has this shape of for all x, x mapped to x. And what does it mean that a function belongs to such a type? A function belongs to such a type if it can be instantiated to any type in this family. So if we are given an identity function that has the type stated here, this identity function can be instantiated, and I put this instantiated in quotes because, for example, in Haskell there is no such thing as instantiation. It's done implicitly. But this actually happens, and this function promises us to work for any type. So it promises us that it can become any type from this family. And with this intuition in mind, we would like to capture this same behavior somehow in the world of relations. So what does it mean that two polymorphic functions are related? So two polymorphic functions will be related if they are related under any instantiation. So if we give any types to those functions, they need to be related. And we are using any relation x because this is the world we are now in. We are not using types anymore, we are in the world of relations. So for any relations, if we instantiate those functions, those types, they need to be related. And that was the hard part. And this is finally over, and I'm so happy that this is finally over. And if something is not clear, I believe it will become clear as soon as we go into the examples. Because it's the dry theory usually isn't the most pleasant thing to work with, but it should become much more intuitive later. So there's also one thing we need to state to put all this together, and this is called the parametricity theorem. And this is the theorem that states that any term is related to itself. So any function, any program is related to itself. And this theorem in the context of this presentation means that we've actually done a good job. Because I wanted to find a setup in which the programs related can be exchanged one for another in any context. So this means that we've done a good job and any program can be interchanged with itself. And this is the theory, and now how do we use this to actually do something useful? So let's start with a quick warm-up exercise. We are given this function that has the same type signature as an identity function. And the question is, what does this function do? What on earth can it actually do? And for now, we don't have any tools to tackle such a problem. I mean, before this whole relational framework, we didn't know how to tackle such a question. Because what does it mean? What can it do? What can we actually... Yes?
How would you read the function?
How would I read the function?
Yeah.
The function that takes an element of type A and returns an element of type A for any type A. Wait, why are you asking this? Okay. So how do we start? And right now, there is only one thing that we know about this function. And this comes from the parametricity theorem. We know that this function is related to itself in the corresponding relation, in the relation corresponding to its type. So this is what we know, and now what we can do is actually go down those definitions, just start to nitpick in the definitions and find something useful. So first part of this relation is the parametric part. So this relation promises us to work with any relation substituted for A. So now this is a matter of picking the right relation, and it's not an easy thing to do. It requires some experience, some experimentation. So if you jump into this yourself, you'll probably need to just try a few things after you find the right relation that will actually solve the problem you are trying to solve. So for now, let's just pick our favorite value, for example, true, and relate true to itself. And this is a relation that contains just this one pair. Nothing else is related to nothing else. So we've substituted this relation A, so we got rid of this scary parametric part with quantification. And what we are left with is an arrow type. And as you recall, an arrow type is something that promises us that if it's applied to related arguments, it gives us related outputs. So can you think of any way to apply this to related values? Well, there's only one way. We need to apply those to truth, because this is the only pair of related values in our relation A. So let's do it. And the only possible output is true and true, because nothing else is related under this relation. So what does this mean? Well, it means that G applied to true is equal to true. And keep in mind that the choice of true as our favorite value was completely arbitrary. So we could have picked one and have this conclusion that G applied to one is equal to one in exactly the same way. We could have picked some function because we have the first order functions, but again we would have this conclusion that G applied to some lambda is the same lambda. So this should convince you that G is an identity function. So this is a pretty interesting side effect of this whole theory, because we've been trying to relate programs, and this simple theorem just gave us this tool to obtain some useful results about functions. And now we can jump to something more involved. So a polymorphic equality operator. So we are concerned with a question if it's possible to have a meaningful equality operator for any terms in our language, for terms of any type. And by meaningful, I mean that it conforms to our intuitions. So for example, true should be equal to true, and true should not be equal to false. And is that possible? And how do we start thinking about this? Well, again, we have only one way of going, and you know the drill already. So let's jump into the parametricity theorem. This equality operator is related to itself in the corresponding relation. And now what is this relation? Well, it has this polymorphic part, this parametric part at the beginning. So we need to substitute something. What do we substitute now? And we can pick something even simpler than in the previous example, or more complicated, it depends on how you look at this. So let's try a full relation. So a full relation is one in which everything is related to everything. You just pick two values, boom, they are related. This is how this magical T works. And we do the substitution. And we are left with this. And what is this? This is an arrow type constructor. So it promises us that it will map related inputs into related outputs. So this translates exactly to this. If we partially apply EQ to some values, the results will be related as long as the initial values are related. And do you remember the definition of T? What does it mean that A and B are related in T? It means nothing. It's true for any A and B. It's just an empty assumption. So we know that those partial applications are related for any A and any B. And what we are left with? Well, it's another function type. So what do we do now? Well, we apply the definition, so it takes related inputs into related outputs. So we introduce some C and D and apply again. And the results will be related as long as C and D are related in T. What does it mean to be related in T? Well, it was on the previous slide already. It means nothing. We can drop this assumption. So the equality operators applied to any four arguments are related in the relation for Booleans. Now, what does it mean to be related as a Boolean? It means to be equal Booleans. Okay, this is how we defined this relation on Booleans. It was an identity relation. So this means that this equality operator gives the same answer no matter what the input is. So it's constantly true or constantly false. So it's not a very useful operator. I mean, I would like an equality operator to be more involved than this. And I believe that now we should be ready to get back to the example I've stated at the very beginning. So let me rephrase it. We have a function, a polymorphic function, that takes a list of A's and returns a list of A's. And now you are probably used to this method, so you perfectly know that what we need to do is apply the parametricity theorem. And we have this parametric type, this parametric part of our relation, which means we get to pick any relation. This is this wonderful freedom of picking any relation. And I've also promised you that the function relations will come in handy later. So now is later. Let's pick a function relation and apply this definition. So this is what we are left with. What is this? Well, it's a function type. It's an arrow type. So it takes related inputs into related outputs. Apply the definition. So f applied to A is related to f applied to B, as long as A and B are related. And we've already found the definition of G extended to lists. It was this short test question I've asked you when we've been defining the relation for lists. So what does it mean that A and B are related? Well, G extended to lists relates A with the result of mapping G over A. So it basically means that B is equal to mapping G over A. So we substitute, because we can. And what we are left with is the same relation again. So with this same relation in mind, we now know that the result of mapping G over the F applied to A is exactly the right coordinate in the pair. This is what we come up with. So let me restate this result. I will use the 0.3 notation, so it's maybe more readable for Haskell users. What does it mean? It means that we can either map something over our list and then apply our function f, or first apply our function f and then map something over the result. And this is our first free theorem. And I don't really like this name, but I'll get to that soon. But how does this theorem actually capture our intuition about this function? We've got this intuition that this function cannot do anything with elements. So this theorem basically says that it doesn't matter if we do something with the elements, because our function doesn't care about elements. We can either change the elements and then reorder them, or first reorder them and then change the element. So the function f is purely a reordering. And more, it's a reordering that works uniformly for any array, any list. And yeah, it's called the free theorem. And now this makes me pretty sad, because I've worked pretty hard to prove this right here. And how the hell is it called free? Well, the sense of freeness in those theorems is a pretty strange one. So notice that we've been working with some abstract function f of some type. And I've said nothing about the implementation of this function. I don't know anything about this function. And I know that for any function of this type signature, this theorem is true. So it's true for tail. And it's true for reverse. And it's true for take applied to 5, because take 5 has exactly the same type signature. And it holds true for drop 3. So I've basically obtained an infinite series of theorems. It's not that just one theorem for one function. It's a theorem that holds for many functions of this type signature. So this is why it's free, because I've worked only once and got all those theorems for free. And there are more of those theorems. So for example, free theorem for list concatenation. It states basically that you can either concatenate lists and then map something over the result, or map something over the arguments and then concatenate. For filter, it's almost commutativity with maps, almost, because we need to also change our predicate that we feed filter with. But the most important part of this example is that this free theorem also works for things like drop while or take while, because they have the same type signature. Even though completely different functions with completely different semantics, the theorem still works. And the theorem for sorts. It states that sort is interchangeable with maps as long as the function we are mapping is monotone. It preserves the ordering. And the same theorem works for nab. Nab is a Haskell name for a function that takes a list and removes duplicates. And it's really interesting because nab has completely different semantics than sort. It takes a function of the type the same as in sort, but it treats this function as an equality operator, not a comparison operator. So it takes an equality operator and removes duplicates. Sort takes comparison operator and sorts the list. So they have nothing in common except for the type signature. And the type signature tells us, well, this theorem will hold true. And why am I telling you this? Does this even matter? Is this even a thing? So yes, it is. It's the free theorems are really a base for many important optimizations. And right now, they are mostly folklore of computer science. It's not like we are using them by name. But the fact that you can either reverse and then map, or first map and then reverse, this fact is probably something you have already used. Maybe without a name, maybe without the knowledge why it does work, but with the intuitive notion that this theorem is true. And where should you go from here? So first, we have two papers. By Philip Wadler, Theorems for Free, and John Reynolds, Types, Abstraction, and Parametric Polymorphism. So the second paper, and chronologically the first paper, introduced the whole idea of treating types as relations. And it's not a very trivial idea, so we should really be happy for Reynolds that he came up with this. I mean, how do you come up with something like, yeah, let's treat our types as relations? But he did this, and it worked. And then Philip Wadler came and said, well, I see an application. We can actually use this to obtain some free theorems. Then there's a video of lectures by Derek Dreyer. Those are lectures from the Oregon Summer School of Programming Languages. And it's a really great thing to watch. It's like 4 hours of basically this, of embedding types in relations. It's a much, much broader context. He also shows us the current state of art in this area. And the current state of art is pretty impressive. I mean, I'm sorry for saying that, guys. I know it's a functional programming conference, but they can handle mutable state. So, yeah, just go and watch it. And then a book by Richard Baird. And this book has nothing to do with free theorems, except it uses it. So. I'm pretty sure that there isn't even a name free theorem stated in the book, but this is a book about designing algorithms that shows you how you can use such theorems to obtain really impressive results, really impressive optimizations. And thank you. That's it. Do you have any questions? Yes?
When did you apply theorems for free?
So the question is, where did I apply the free theorems? So I applied them during designing some algorithms, but it was just for fun. I mean, I'm not a really practical guy, but yeah, it was just some play with algorithms. Okay, thank you.